Hi everyone, welcome to a new OtanyML Talks. Today we are with Andrea Basso, Research Director of Synesthesia, and we are going to listen from him about standardized AI architecture for secure TinyML. But before to leave him the floor, let me spend a few words about our strategic partners. Without their commitment, these and other events could not happen. So we are grateful to them for all the support they provide: AI Zip, analog devices, Arduino, ARM, BrainChip, Edge Impulse, GreenWaves Technologies, Groverty, IBM, ImageMob, Infineon, Inatera, Microsoft, Not AI, NXP, Poling Technology, Quixo, Qualcomm, Renesas, Schneider Electric, Sensinil, Sony, Silicon Labs, STMicroelectronics, Synaptics, and Syntiant. Couple of things. The TinyML community is growing more and more. Just in the last 3 months, 1,800 more members. For a total of 15.2 in 49 groups in 41 countries. So this community is really expanding, and also there is an equivalent TinyML community on LinkedIn. If you are a subscriber, fantastic. If not, please join us and stay updated with the latest news and developments, which are shared by the community. Amazingly, lots of videos are available on the YouTube channel. These are close to 600 videos for a great amount of information covering different aspects on device learning tools, tutorial context, challenges, applications, new products being announced, lots of information that are in the same place in a unique community at worldwide level. Next week, TinyML Innovation Forum will take place in Amsterdam, so join us there. Let me introduce quickly Andrea Basso, which is serving as a research director in Synesthesia in Italy, where he manages the research and development activities on artificial intelligence and IoT. He is chair of AIFDC in MPI. MPI is a community that standardizes various topics in the artificial intelligence field and is led by Leonardo Chiariglione. You know, Leonardo was the father of the MPEG multimedia standards. Andrea is also advisor of the Progress Tech Transfer Investment Fund. He's also served as a CTO of Mito Technology Italy, senior expert of the European Commission and for YIPO. In previous position, served as CEO of Sisler Technology and CTO of the Sisler Group, where he oversaw evolution of Sisler strategic technology area and worked on business strategy and new market development. An amazing amount of patents, 182 granted, mainly in the area of multimedia indexing and video coding. Aperta parentesis, Andrea is a veteran on video encoding standard. He is one of the most knowledgeable people with outstanding experiences in that field. You should learn his bio, which is very important, interesting. While he was in Bell Labs and ETP Labs Research USA, he was a research manager with 22 years of research experience on multimedia technology and developed innovative service and architecture for IPTV and over-the-top. Andrea has been involved in development of standards, several international bodies, IETF, ISO, and MPEG. I know very well Andrea in MPEG for his contribution over the year, 3GPP, IPUP, and IITC. 60 papers or several books chapters. He's a frequent speaker in international conference and events. I'm so pleased and excited to have introduced you, Andrea, and I leave the floor listening to your outstanding speech. Thank you.
Thank you. Allora, if you give me the control, perfect, we can move to the presentation. Hi, everyone. It is a pleasure, actually, to be here and to talk to Tania Mel Talks. So what we're gonna spend around an hour together, and mainly what I want to communicate is the effort that we are doing in standardization of AI frameworks to enable in fact and to democratize AI in particular on MCUs. This is the outline that we're going to cover today. So I'm going to say very few words about TinyML, just for those of you that are new to these events and to this topic. Then I'm going to talk about MPAI and in particular all the AI framework that I chair. I will cover, what are the benefits, in fact, of this kind of approach. And then we're going to talk about some of the implementation that we did on MCU of this framework. And we're going to spend the last part of the presentation on the security component, that is the new version of the IEF, because security is so important that we couldn't forget about it. Okay, so what is TinyML? I think all of you know what we are talking about, but is, you know, it refers in general to the deployment of machine learning algorithms that typically, are known to be complex, definitely in the learning, but also in the inference part on small computers, small MCUs that are constrained resources in terms of memory, in terms of processing power, even if they're becoming more and more sophisticated in adding all the elements like the FPU, like the DSPs that are part of the MCU architecture, so that they can efficiently use also in AI. There are a lot of advantages, I would say, in having TML developed, simply because AI is no longer necessarily in the cloud, but it is deployed locally. That implies, in fact, that you operate in a low latency mode, and AI is more and more used also in mission critical systems in which millisecond counts, and so the notion of latency is very important. Energy efficiency, I think is the hot topic of these days, and AI is well known for consuming a lot of energy, and instead, with the proper implementation maybe of distributed AI in architecture like the one I'm going to present today, allow to have quite complex functionality at the edge, low latency, with little consumption, power consumption. Typical examples of this are smart wearables, sensors. Now there are sensors that include machine learning capabilities inside that also combine this with other elements, so that the overall consumption is the order of milliwatts, if not less. And of course IoT. We are expecting a myriad of devices deployed. It's already quite large amount has been deployed, and intelligence need to be where is needed in a distributed way. So TinyML can do a lot for that. I think already mentioned some of the advantages of TinyML. So the notion really of edge computing, it is important, but not only. These days, another very hot topic is privacy and security. No, the fact that you don't have to move data around, they do not need to be transported, and they remain on the device, really minimizes the privacy concern, and also can limit the reliance on network connectivity. So the, in fact, the system ends up to be much more reliable. Of course, you know, the fact that that I do the inference at the edge, you know, brings energy efficiency simply because I just remove the round trip of the data from the device to the inference engine and back, e quindi and so also extending the overall energy efficiency of the system. And another important point is you know, scalability. The fact that I can deploy a lot of small devices with AI capabilities allow me to build quite complex systems, you know, with a combined inference capability considerable, but in a very scalable and in a very smooth smooth way, because the endpoints are intelligent and they can aggregate together, combine inference capabilities, and also, you know, combine functionalities. And it's exactly, you know, some of the aspect that we actually took into consideration for the development of the framework I'm gonna talk about in a few minutes. Now, in terms of, you know, workflow for TinyML, the workflow is the typical you know, AI workflow, machine learning workflow, in which you have a phase in which you do data collection, and then you know, you so that you can create the data sets and the training sets that are needed for creating the AI models. Model development, and also here, you know, there are a variety of things that you need to take into account, because this is a tiny model, so you need to take into account already from the model development what are the constraints that that you need in terms of memory, in terms of processing powers, and so on. And then there is a very important part that is really the focus of a lot of effort and research in TinyML, that is the model optimization. So how I can optimize the you know, the representation. So how I can quantize, can I go to FP16 or INT8 or any other form, and where I need to go. There are techniques that allow you to prune your network so that you can remove the part that give less contribution, in fact, to the overall result, and so that you can take a model that maybe is complex at the beginning and create a model that maybe hundreds of kilobytes at the end, and you can deploy on a minimum hardware on a very small and also very cost effective MCU. And then another big area of you know, of importance is how you deploy these models. And there are aspects related to the security of the deployment of these models. If you are in a mission critical situation, of course, you cannot just switch off the inference engine. So there are issues related to how you can ensure reliability and effectiveness, so that, for example, you can maintain the five nines of your system, so in terms of reliability, and of course, you know, how you can make sure that you can update the models properly through, you know, structured deployment, so that you can take care of you know, model drift or data drift and any kind of changes that, for example, your environment may have, and so you need to adapt the network. Okay, so this is a very quick overview. It's an elevator pitch on TinyML, and I want to say something about MPAI. Danilo already said something about it. MPAI stands for Moving Picture Audio and Data Coding by Artificial Intelligence. We focus on picture and audio, but I would say that the largest focus is on data. And so as data, we cover a lot of scenario. MPAI is an international unaffiliated non-profit organization that is focused on developing standards in the area of AI. One of the advantages with respect to other standardization schemes and organizations is that has a very simple and easy to use IPR, intellectual property right management and licensing framework, so that the adoption of some technology, it's very easy for application developers, for technology developers, for users. We actually wrote a book on that, and you see here the title is Toward a Pervasive and Trustworthy Artificial Intelligence. Here you see all the list of the authors that are, you know, the chairs of the different groups of MPAI and also contributors. If you go to the link here, you can actually download an electronic copy of the book. Okay, so now let's go to the key topic that we want to discuss today. So this AI framework. AF stands for AI framework, and the idea that we had behind this framework was really to provide a standardized way in which, you know, AI components that we call AI modules can easily be plugged in and use standard interface, so that you know, with a set of modules combined together, you can develop complex AI functionalities or complex applications. And it's you know, the idea is somehow related to Lego, the Lego blocks. You know, what drove us was really to have the capability of easy combining different modules, being able to you know, shop around for the best module that you could plug in, and so to create application very, very quickly. And of course, you know, the driver of this is interoperability, because standardizing the interfaces allow us, you know, to have different modules that are tested to work together, and also being able to scale, so that, you know, we can combine a large number of these for complex functionalities, to have this in a distributed manner, and to be able to deploy them on a variety of devices and platforms, and also, you know, not only for MCUs, but also, you know, for a much more complex distributed system, still keeping the same philosophy. So as you see, it's a quite ambitious task, but you know, we are doing quite a bit of progress on this. I'm just going to check if there are questions on the chat. If there are questions on that, there are none. Perfect. So we can keep going. Okay, so and so of course, you know, if we want to reach this level of flexibility and this level of composability, the objective is, you know, to create a standard. Why a standard? Because a standard, you know, first of all, is structured in a way that you know, can be easily used, because of course you need to be quite rigorous in defining the different, you know, the different interfaces, the different components, explaining how you can use this functionality. It is a common language, no, that can be used for you know, a lot of scenarios, for the application developer that knows, you know, how this interface works, for the technology developer that develops the IAM and know, you know, which are the things that he has to expose outside. So standardization is probably, you know, the best way of doing this, instead of trying to push, for example, a de facto standard. So we really start top down, you know, starting from a standardization effort with a large community involved. Also, because we believe that these allow the growth of an ecosystem around this you know, this standardization, that also foster and activates collaboration and innovation among the different stakeholders of the ecosystem. Okay, so finally, this is you know, a very high level picture of the framework. And so we're going to go through all the different components. Well, you see here, you know, these green boxes are the AI modules. And these are modules that provide some level of functionality. They have inputs and they have outputs that are somehow, these interfaces are standardized. And mainly we provide to the IAMs the possibility of being together, and actually we do this dynamic through metadata, and that they can use some you know, internal storage, so that for example they can share data. They may have a private storage space. And the only thing that we really, you know, specify is these black lines that you see in the picture. So the interfaces. We don't really standardize what is inside this module. It can be a very simple module, or it can be extremely complex. From a logical perspective, for us, as an input, a standard input, a standard output, and it may access all the other components of the framework. And the other components of the framework are, of course, a controller that, you know, has the role of, you know, controlling the modules, starting them, stopping them, you know, suspending them, combining them together in what we call an IW, an AI workflow. Identifying, you know, the way in which the IAMs can access the other functionalities, so the user agent, the communication global storage access, so that, you know, inside a framework you can have one or multiple workflows that are controlled by the controller, and the controller somehow is responsible also to manage the interface toward the other elements of the framework. Some of them are indicated here. There is a user agent that has the role of control. Now you can imagine that you know, I can implement through a framework like this a functionality, a very simple functionality. For example, you know, an AI module that can detect the behavior, you know, through a variety of sensors, and then give the result to another module that, on that basis, you know, may take a different kind of action that may go to signaling something, to change its behavior with respect, I don't know, to audio, to video, whatever. As well as, you know, having something that is way more complex, in which the AI modules, instead of being in a single physical location, they can be connected together through a mean that can be a network, that can be a variety of things, and then implement the functionality. So these are the modules. So we talked about the workflow, that is a combination of modules, and the workflow can be created dynamically through metadata that is specified in JSON. The controller, we also said, has this capability of starting, stopping workflows, but also being able to access the individual models. And then you see the other component. I think communication, global storage, access are somehow tradition. Communication is really communication to the outside world. Eh? So it's the HTTPS or CoAP, secure CoAP or whatever. It depends on the implementation that you're using. So that the AI framework can communicate with the rest of the world. Global storage, it's an interface toward slow changing data that we wanted to separate from all the rest. They can be, the data models, the AI models that are used here, maybe databases that need to be accessed, but also global storage can be a storage area network or something like that. Access instead, it's even more high level. It's for example access to other remote data that is not included in the global storage area, and I'm not going to go too much in detail into that. If you're curious, you can have a look to the spec. But finally, I want to spend a few words about the MPI store. So what we thought is in fact to go with the stream. Now today you can get software, you can get components through repositories that have applications, and so the famous stores from Apple, from Google, in which you can download, you pay for the application. Well, what we did, we extended the concept to the individual components. So on the MPI store, works in fact very similar on how a store, an application app store works, but you can actually get the individual IAM, and through the store, you can also upgrade or change your workflow, your application. And this gives a bit more functionality, because in general, these are functionality that is given to the developers, but we want to have a larger view for the MPI store, in the sense that we would like to enable even the users, in fact, to do the improvement of a component, if this is allowed, because sometimes, there may be some testing, some validation that need to be done. And so this process becomes more, more complex, but somehow to be able to consider the possibility of changing the modules, as much as possible, so that you can improve, upgrade, modify the functionality that you have. And these, of course, allow a much more important, flexibility in your system. Now here there are a bit more data. I think I covered all of them. The only thing that I didn't say is that the controller actually has three APIs, because as I said, you need to talk to the other elements of the framework. So one is toward the AI modules. The second one is toward the user, so the external control, and the user here can be another controller. So think these quite in large, in large view. You can combine these IEFs together through a user agent so that you can implement complex redundant functionalities and so on. And then, one thing that we thought it's really innovative here is this notion of API store with its own API that allow you actually to pick and get individual component. And also all the transaction piece, even economic transaction will be managed by the MPI store. Okay, so here, we talked about the relevance of the interfaces. This is what we standardize and what we focus on. We in the first release, the 1.1 of the IF, the three that I mentioned have been defined, but they have also capability of being extended. Few more details about the framework. This is a bit more technical. The framework support both an event-based system, in which there are events that are generated, and then the controller or the other component receive the event and react to the events. We have also defined ports and channels, in particular because we wanted to support mixed hardware and software implementations, so that in fact you can combine your FPGA with software components. And as I said, there is a notion of distribution of the functionality, in particular controller, can that is always present. Can be also run remotely. Machine can be just a controller, and all the other can operate as IAM, as IWs, as a combination of them. And also, we implemented a scheme that allowed the IAMs to be hot pluggable and have a dynamic registration capability, so that the system is very, very flexible and minimizes the downtime for that. I think we did a quite good job, and very recently the IEF became also an IEEE standard that goes under the name of P3301. And you can actually buy it if you want. There is an IEEE working group that is the P3301 Artificial Intelligence Framework Working Group, where I'm the vice chair. And again, if you're interested, more than welcome to join. And again, what are the benefits of TinyML combined to IF? Well, TinyML is really exploring how machine learning can be brought to small devices, to MCUs. The IF provides somehow a standardized framework for doing it, and also provides a way in which these systems that may be individually very limited, but their combination can be complex and very powerful system. So it gives scalability, it gives a way of providing complexity scalability, and makes this very, very easy in the sense that with the MPI store, also this combination, it doesn't require you to recompile the overall system, but actually, you simply download, combine, and you have it running. Imagine the effect on the time to market of a prototype. So, having said that, I spoke a lot, but I want to give you a sense that this is real. So I want to mention a couple of use cases with that. We actually implemented. I will show the very first one. It's a very simple system that has two AI modules, so a single workflow with a relatively simple functionality. Mainly the first AI module, does audio scene classification, has been trained, you know, using in this case using the STMicro electronic AI environment, and then you know controls is connected to a second AI module that changes its behavior of processing audio. And you know can enable can is in, from you know sampling the audio at 360 degree can enable a beamforming mode if it detects that the user for example it's you know is moving or the audio scene becomes particularly complex. And so, you know, this functionality, the beamforming improves a lot the audio experience. So here it's you know the block diagram. As I said, we used STMicroelectronic boards for this. We used two of them: the sensor tile and the blue coin. So you know the sensor tile has microphone sensors and also inertial and environmental sensor that we use. This component allowed to do you know an activity detection as well as you know an audio scene detection. And mainly the audio scene detection in particular is the one that changed the behavior of the second IEM that you know changes its modality of sampling sampling the audio. And this is a tool that we developed in you know for improving audio conferencing performance. And the picture that you see here is you know the two boards that are connected together. So in this case, in fact, the controller that runs on the sensor tile, you know, is connected, is remote, and the second IEM runs on a different board, and the wires that you see here are the connection between the two IEMs, and you see here the LEDs they change because actually indicate that. Is moving to a beamforming, so it's actually looking for identifying where the sound is coming from. I want to give you another use case example. This one is a bit more complex. We implemented it also in. On ST hardware on the IoT node. Here you see there are a lot of details because this is a full implementation of the spec, including all the metadata for configuring the different IEMs and the workflow, all the mechanisms for you know managing events and dispatching them to the other component, as well as you know the communication. This was using in fact CoAP. This is the code for this is available also on GitHub. And the use case it's very very simple. The system generates a click and a sound. The user need to do the movement at the same time in which he hears the sound, and if he does it correctly, then it's good. There's one green LED that turns on. If he doesn't, then there is a red LED that turns on. If you want to have a bit more details, we actually published a paper that describes of all the details of the implementation. Here there are some references of other papers that we published on this, and I want to quickly move to what we are doing now for security. This is the new version of the IEF. It's almost complete. Of course, you know, security is really very important and is an essential element to allow, in fact, the framework, to pick up, and also TinyML, because, who want to have a system that is not secure for managing and processing data that are maybe very relevant, very personal. So, one thing that we are looking at is also the how to protect the model, so that unauthorized use of the model is blocked directly at the device level. And we are doing this with watermarking of the model. Again, there is a working group actually working just on that. So I'm just mentioning it. If you want, go on the MPI store. MPI website, sorry, and then you can get all the details on that. And the other important thing is we want to be able to create a proper framework so that it can be certified and compliance can be also verified. So, and I think the standard can really play a key role for that. Mainly, what we are trying to do is, it's quite challenging because, we have multiple technology providers with potentially different requirements that we need to combine together. And also, the same modules, the same components can be used by multiple users with potentially different security requirements. And the third thing that we would like to do in this effort is allow application developer to select the security. Sorry, components that they need. So I'm gonna give you just a glimpse on what we are doing. We are adding, a set of services here. You see secure communication, encryption services, attestation services. We developed what we call the security abstract layer, so that the access to the services is simple. And on the other side, also, of course, we included the capability of having secure storage. Now, this seems simple, but it's quite complex, and the way in which need to be implemented. We are starting from something really simple with a single IAM that can be composite, so may have individual sub IAM in its part. We complete the part on secure storage, on communication, and all the attestation encryption services that we need to provide. Okay, I want to conclude. I believe really a lot in this effort of standardization. I hope it will go far and will be an enabler for AI in tiny devices. So TinyML, I hope will take advantage of all this effort. And as I said, we are putting a lot of effort now on security because we think that this is a key part of the overall game, to have the AIF be deployed on some level of scale. Having said that, thank you very much. And again, if you have questions, I'm here. And then I think I stop sharing, and then I give the floor to Danilo again.
Thank you so much, Andrea. There is a question while you were sharing the block diagram of the AIF framework, and the question was about if the system shown in the block diagram represents the software or hardware
They can be both, exactly. So they can be both. As I said, it's a very high level representation, and if you want really to get the details, there are the 92 pages that wait for you to be read in detail, in which we actually specify the kind of formats, how you serialize the data and so on. But in principle, the framework can operate both on hardware and software, and also a combination of them. So you can get an FPGA and interface with software IAMs.
Thank you. There is also another question. How do you see MPI and TinyML community working together? What this task needs to be done?
Sorry, I didn't get the second part of the question. Are you seeing the community work together?
Yeah, essentially yes, because you are presenting in front of the TinyML community. So how MPI and TinyML community could work together, and what are the big tasks that need to be done?
Okay, so I would say while TinyML really focuses on what is inside the IAMs, and how to combine them in workflows. MPI IF provides the container in which you can put all these things. So we are quite, I would say, complementary. But the important thing is that we talk together, to make it this work. There are several ways in which we can collaborate. You are more than welcome to join, the MPI initiative, and I think we can even open up a formal channel of communication between the TinyML community and MPAI to have regular changes on progress.
Thanks. There is another question. Can you briefly talk about all different MPI standards and what is the main difference between them?
Okay, so mainly the standards, there are a lot, and there are, I think, 16, but they are divided mainly in use cases, and then the framework. Okay, the framework is a common basis for all the different use cases that are covered in MPAI. And in terms of use cases, we go from audio, video coding, metaverse scenarios, autonomous vehicle use cases, and so on. As I said, they are listed on the MPI website. But the common part is really the framework. All the use cases use the same framework that I presented today.
Very good. And there is another question. Is the framework free to use, Andrea? And I would add, where open source implementation could be found?
Okay, there is a GitHub implementation, GitHub repository that should be open. And there is also one in the MPAI. You can just go and look for IF, and again, if you need, I can provide the link. And I think you just need to request access, and then you can access the internal GitHub with the implementation that I actually saw. So if you buy one of the boards, you can download the code directly on the board.
In terms of security aspect, are you going to consider also to handle adversarial attacks, which
yes,
usually fool the environment?
Yes. So there is, in fact, a part of the standard that covers, what are the scenarios, the threat scenarios that we're going to consider, and yes, that is definitely in the list. Because if these are IoT devices, you really need to take that into account. Otherwise,
you know that also, Andrea, the TinyML community and the foundation host lots of local chapter and also working groups. There are a few working groups. I don't remember all of them, but certainly they are many, rich, and diversified. The one that I take care of is the on-device there. What is MPI doing, in this direction?
Well, again, you mean in terms of working groups or?
In terms of efforts or initiatives. If it is okay. Under the radar of MPI.
Yeah, I mean, we are actually opening up quite a bit. We had interaction also with the Eclipse Foundation and so on to open up as much as possible. You know, we want to make again the framework free of use, so that you know can be used, tested, extended, and to make it available to the community. Because I really believe that that is one of the best ways to test and expand the overall effort. Again, I think it can be very interesting to create a bridge, in fact, to between TinyML and MPAI toward this. So again, more than willing to talk about that.
And there is another question. In the meanwhile, who will manage the module store and will it be monetized in the future?
Okay, the that is what in fact the MPI store does. You know, an application we call technology developers, the developers of the IAM. They are on the store, and some of them are not free. Really, you know, if you want to use that module, you have to pay. And the store will also take care, as it's happening today with the app stores. So you will be able to you know pay very quickly through an account and take that component into your framework. And it is not only the developer that can do that, but is actually the user. So for example, if I want to plug in a more sophisticated AI camera software in my framework, that is of course compatible with the one that I have and compatible with my AI framework implementation, I can simply go to the store and buy the enhanced AI camera software.
Very good.
Yeah, it's really reusing, you know, reusing the same business model that that the App Store uses today. But what is different here is we go to the component level, and we give, you know, we are at the beginning, but the idea is to give access to the users also, so that they can upgrade their own their own products, you know, by themselves.
Very good. It seems there are no other open questions. In terms of case studies or application, Andrea, what are the most important in your radar for the AIP framework for the future? I mean.
Okay, so in addition to I would say the framework, that is the one that is advancing, I think, at higher speed with respect to the other, and that is obvious because without container is difficult. The part on audio is making a lot of improvement, also because audio is one of the areas in which I think TinyML may play an interesting role, and you know, smart sensors, you know, based on this kind of framework, is also progressing well. And video, video actually obtained better results than I think the standard today. I think was presented in IBC, if I well remember. So we have also very good results in terms of coding.
Andrea, there is another question. Is there a certification authority for components and implementation?
Right. Yeah. You touch a very hot topic that gave us a lot of headache. Yes, we have a certification authority that generates the root, you know, the root certificates for the system. We had to create one to be able to have everything in place.
There is Rob Franzo, which compliments with you about the presentation, the content, and wanted to share with you the delight in assisting.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It is my pleasure. I always enjoy this.
Is noted. Very good. 5 minutes to left to the end of this TinyML talk. First of all, Andrea, thanks so much for your
Thank you.
time for the willingness to contribute and share this interesting subject, which is MPI, and in particular the developments you take care in MPI. I think is beneficial for the community and very informative. So thanks again. Your time has been appreciated as well as your talk, and I'm sure the community will take benefit of it also. For who did not attend, will enjoy the video recording you share in a day or so. Thanks so much, and let me go back to the presentation. As per the other Stanimal talks, this event was happening thanks to our support of our strategic partners, which are listed here, and I remember at the beginning of the presentation. And in particular, let's go through the executive strategic partners: Edgeimpulse, Qualcomm, Syntiant, the Platinum strategic partners, Renesas, Aetrios, the Gold strategic partners, Analog Devices, Arduino, ARM, Infineon, Inatera, Microsoft, Sensimin, STMicroelectronics, Synaptics, and the Silver strategic partners, AIZIP, BrainChip, GreenWaves, Grogerty, IBM, Imaging, Bob, Not.ai, NXP, Poling Technology, Quixel, Schneider Electric, and Silicon Labs. Thanks a lot for your time and be with us together. And thanks again to Andrea, and hope to see you soon. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.